floor is given to the moderator of the roundtable, Alexey Shukin.
Good afternoon. My name is Alexey Shukin. I'm a special correspondent of the Expert magazine. I'll be the moderator of our roundtable, which is about Kazan satellite city Napolis. And let me introduce the participants of our roundtable. These are Igor Ivanov, head of the Annapolis city, mayor of the city, Timur Kadyrov, he is the architect urbanist from the Systematic Company, Alexander Loshkin, architect urbanist, mayor's advisor of Novosibirsk city, he works in the area of urban planning, Andrei Chelsov, partner of the ABBA Studio Company. He is a co-author and general designer of the business, the Skolko Business School. Mikhail Alexeyevsky is the head of the Center of the City Anthropology, Strelka Design Bureau. Ksenia Makrushin, head of the Urban Research Center, Skolkova. Karima Nigmatulina, independent expert, and we all remember that just a short time ago, she was one of the top people in the Moscow urban planning. Edward Morrow, founder of the Off the Grid Studio, and Alex Shapiro, managing partner of the Architecture of Design Bureau, Wauhaus. And let me say a couple of words about our roundtable, so that to set the tempo of discussion. And several years ago, I visited Kazan, and I heard an idea about the designing of the satellite city of Kazan, and two sites were being considered as the for the satellite city, and it was percepted as the fantastic idea. And yesterday, we visited this site. Just in 2 years, they have built the first buildings in Technopark, universities, several blocks of residential areas, road infrastructure, and if a year ago, 2 years ago, it could have been considered in the polls as just a multiplication of the or copy of Skolkova, urban satellite city. So now, when you entered this project 2 years later, 2 years after Skolkova, Kazan in the polls actually is ahead in its development, which is an interesting fact by itself. And the ambitions are just unbelievable, because you know, maybe in the 2030 they will have there will be about 150,000 people, and it will be a place for the high-tech business technologies. And the two topics are very interesting. First is it's a topic of the new cities. It's very interesting area, very full of controversies, because in Europe, for example, they don't, for the last 20 years, they haven't been building any new cities, and the fashion is changing very quickly. And 20 years ago, some cities which were a source of inspiration and delight, and in Brazil, for example, Brasilia, or Sundigarh in India, later on they were percepted as the failures in architecture urban planning, because this urbanistic fashion is very changeable. And when you build a city for century and the fashion changes, well, it's a different situation. And the second challenge is that high-tech business city Annapolis gets into the stage, it gets into struggle with the Silicon Valley, for example, with the French, British, Chinese technopolises. They are fighting and competing for investment, for brains, for companies. And we'll be talking more about urban environment. And I'm interested in three questions, and they are very much connected with the ambitions which we have in 150,000 people. First is, what is high-tech urban environment? What are its elements? What are the instruments of its building? And this in Annapolis, it's always innovations, and it's always a breakthrough. How can we get out of this Brezhnev stagnation, Brezhnev Corbusier area, when we were building these micro blocks? And the second, so far as we are competing with such powerful brands on the global level, how to build something really interesting as Annapolis, so that you can stick out positively? How can we attract people here? What are the unique features, and we're talking about the ambitious projects. It's kind of a super goal, super challenge to create something like cognitive city. I mean, city for smart people, a city which multiplies the brain resources and mind resources. And I would like to give floor to the Innopolis mayor, give him floor for his presentation. So I'd like him to give him floor. He is the head, Mr. Ivanov, he's the head of Innopolis municipality. Good afternoon, colleagues. To begin with, I would like to follow up the topic of urbanization, which we already talked today about, and the different statistics were given. That, the, for example, our population will be 150,000, and I like the tempo, and I. We know that every year we have 7 million people moving from villages to urban areas, and it means that there is a global competition for human resources which are moving to urban areas. And I sincerely believe that very often place of residence defines the life of person more than connections, more than education, because the area of residence or place of residence defines your level of your well-being, your partners and everything. And competition is on the international market. If we, for example, talk about IT area, about Innopolis, so in spite of IT being the most demanded specialty in every country, there are no such countries which can which don't have jobs to offer this, but people still continue migrating. And if you look at statistics, Russia, well, we don't have several hundred thousand specialists, and million maybe, still we have a brain drain. Russian IT specialists leave the country, leave Russia. At the same time, there is internal competition for the best specialists. I'm talking about competition among cities. And in our case, Moscow is an absolute monopolist and leader, because they can pay higher salaries, they pay more money, because they have more challenging tasks, because 50% of the market in money, in rubles. Of course, this market attracts the best, the most promising ones. Cities are beginning to compete for the city dwellers, for the city residents, as the companies do. They form their unique product proposals. Berlin, cultural center, because it has been always supported by the government. It's the unquestionable and undisputable hub of Dubai, for example, hub of the Dublin. It's like a legal offshore of the European Union. All of these cities give their unique proposals, and that they're competing for the best, which can move forward their developing economies. And coming back to Innopolis, and using this analogy with the companies, Innopolis has even more challenging tasks, and not just competition for the city dwellers as the clients on the existing market. It's a fight, it's desire to get on the super competitive, super challenging market. Well, it's I'm much involved into this story, because this is my personal experience in city planning. And in this approach, we have several key elements. It's a behavioristical model, or management of the city as a service company. It is the attitude to the city as a startup project. And in the case of Innopolis, it is exactly the one. And of course, the attitude to citizens of this Innopolis as a clients. What is important on this stage is team. Has a paramount importance. It's a simple truth, but I, as a person who has completed three different startups, different size startups, I have to say that the team at the very beginning, on the very inception stage, is the most important which we can have. It's not just you move one person and replace one person to another. No. what person you choose and where from and what competence this person has, will the whole project will hang on these right choices. Flexibility and ability to work in the real world. There are several types of people. People who work in the public domain, and people who work in big corporations, and people who build startups. Those who build startups, we have very, very few of them. It's minority because it's the ability to work in ever-changing atmosphere, situation, which for most people, it's not a competence. It is a natural ability of person. Either you have it or you don't. Most people work in stress, and there are people which get pleasure from the stress, but we don't have a lot of these people. This is approach when we don't have to implement any strategic plans, and when you have to implement some solutions and get the feedback as soon as possible. And in Innopolis, we did it with the concierge service. At when we conducted first event in Innopolis in the end of May, we implemented very simple service. The residence area manager. We trained a lot some girls based on virtual training office, and we tested this project. This project was very successful because this house management service was very, very successful. Well, that you can have people, and all everyday's issues can be solved very, very easily. And of course, it's target management, because how it works in big companies usually, for example, used on the model of collecting money for budget, people from bottom to top, they get some kind of money, and they follow the budget. No, in startup you cannot do it. In startup it's works differently. If the task of building Innopolis had been given to the builders, Innopolis would have appeared in 7 years. But so far as the goal was set to erect this city in 2 years, people started looking for methods how to solve complicated tasks rather than looking for the lame excuses how not to do things. What is the model of the city management as the service company, as utility company? It's exactly like it's in business. It's a clear segmentation, compartmentalization, understanding the needs and the requirements of your clients. It's a focus on marketing, promotion, on advancing and promoting your services to clients. It's a situation when the loyalty of people, and where they recommend their friends and their family members to move to the city, becomes KPI. And of course, when we focus on the financial indicators, on the ARPOR, and this is it's a business term, and appropriate per capita, for person, to put it in simple terms. And of course you have to follow these things, because a lot of people use these services.
In business, in terms of focus on a client and a client-oriented approach, there are such terms as customer experience and customer journal. In doesn't translate very well into Russian language. This is a client experience and client's track. The same, if we apply the same to city planning, this is sort of a path of a citizen through the city when the city management function is to track and to understand each point of a contact of a citizen with the city, from the very first point when he or she learns from the press or social networks about what the city is, where, what kind of a city it is, that there is such a citizenopolis, and all the path of a citizen experience, including the acceptance of certain circumstances or making decisions, for example, to come or to live in this city or to leave it. So it is very important to be very client-oriented to what services are offered to citizens. This is my vision of a city of the 21st century and how it should develop. If we speak about practical matters as to specifically to what we have at this point, simply speaking, I can say that there is this grand problem of an egg and a hen. There are no citizens. If there are no citizens, infrastructural businesses are not ready to come there. Services are not ready to come there. The infrastructure that would build new facilities, new buildings. And if there is no infrastructure, no services, citizens are not ready to go there. The next big challenge that Innopolis is facing, the state has given a strong impetus to the city by building the entire infrastructure, what makes and turns Innopolis into a city. The next stage would be to attract private investors for all sorts of projects, including high quality city environment and the development of city places. And before the city becomes large and before it starts generating large amounts of money and guarantees payoff, still, how do we build the proper environment? Because this is a really big challenge. Innopolis has to compete with key IT clusters in the world, major clusters. First of all, with Moscow. Secondly, with all other international world clusters. And another big challenge, my own challenge, is how to gather a strong team, because it should be a mix of between experience in municipal management, in business, in city development, urban planning, because there are very few people with this diverse background. And again, those who have this experience create this chicken and egg problem again, because many people who have this experience are in Moscow, but they are not prepared yet to come and to leave Moscow and come here. So these are the questions that I would like to address to the audience. Thank you very much for this presentation. I would like to ask you a question. If we look at Technopolises, innovative cities that were built recently, they have a certain uniqueness in them. For example, Masdar is a city with a taxi where there are unmanned taxis. It uses zero energy. It is a city that generates energy in itself, lots of other innovative. Do you think that Innopolis has found its own uniqueness, and what does it offer that is most innovative? Let's first of all speak about why do we need Innopolis and why it came to existence. I already said that Russia, despite large need in IT resources, loses annually a large number of IT specialists. Now the flow of labor movement is either from small cities to Moscow and then from Moscow to abroad. And of course, this outflow is a problem. On the other hand, the outflow from regions to the capital might be a lesser problem, as it may seem to many, because intellectual resources still stay within the country, they continue creating a product. Still, I believe that this is a very bad, it is not very good, because regional economy loses a lot because of it, because those guys who stay in their own cities and towns, for some reason, they are either not too ambitious, or for some of them it's difficult to move up, to move on. They lose a lot because you cannot really develop without being in a professional environment, without having to solve challenging tasks, whereas those who can take solve this challenging task, they move away. So those who stay, they might not be necessarily less talented. In many cases, they might be more talented, more hardworking, but they become less effective. So the Innopolis has this challenge to create an alternative to this one-way outflow of labor movement. How can we do this? Basically, a person wants to work and live where he or she is born. If they leave, they leave for better conditions, in search of better life, what is specific to our country also, to have certain stability, which is hard to find in their in your native city. And so this stability is probably the key reason why a person goes abroad. If we look at the United States, people move around and change cities at least once in some 6 years. First of all, we're a little bit less conservative about moving around. First of all, it has to deal with a lot of problems. When you go to another city, you have to find a new job, you have to find a place to live. It's not so easy to do. There are problems also to have access to social infrastructure. So at this very basic stage, that what we can offer is this stability. You come to a new city, here is the job, here is the clear residence with the clear conditions, all necessary infrastructure is there, daycares, medical centers, etc., with very transparent terms of use. So this comfort, this is the comfort that we can offer, and this is a competitive advantage compared to Moscow. This is stability, comfortable living conditions and working conditions, wonderful natural environment. Thank you very much. I believe there will be more questions. I'd like to apologize. There is one more participant in our discussion, Shayu Faiz Rahmanov, who is the representative of the Siemens in the Volga region. I bring my apologies to you. Now the floor is given to Timur Kadyrov, an architect at the urban company Systematica. He was born in Kazan. He's an architect, an urbanist. He works now in Italy, and would like to hear his outlook and his opinion. And he will put Innopolis into the world context. Thank you very much, colleagues. Thank you very much for this possibility, for giving me the possibility to speak in my native city. As it has been said, I work as an urbanist in Systematica. We, for example, did offer to Meganom transportation consultations. And today my main topic is Innopolis. And in my presentation, I would like to introduce some world examples to you. Just a very brief overview for lack of time. I would like to start with the overarching concepts. What do we mean by saying creative environment or creative city? For the first time, this concept was introduced by Charles Landry, in the end of the 80s. And the idea behind it was that each city has its own resources to become innovative and creative. And creativity meant not a component of some artsy, in some artsy sense, but creativity in terms of economics and management. The second concept is creative class, which was introduced by Richard Florida. And the concept is based on the it's a 3T concept: tolerance, talent, and besides, this creative economy is becoming very popular in respect of city management also. Speaking practically, the first example is the European Center for Studying Matters, which is now being built in Lund in Sweden, not far from Limer city. It is called the Second Android Collider. And designers took a very interesting approach to city planning and creating good working conditions. You can see here the key areas, which include creating an environment that would be well-scaled to a human being, to man. Also, clusterization of different ideas, but at the same time, creating spaces that would help the city fill it with life. Also, using landscape approaches and methods, and using nature, bringing nature closer to working places, so that while working, a man or a woman can go out and be out in the nature. Also, in indoor spaces were interestingly arranged. I apologize that the pictures are not so clearly shown here. Here we can see, if you can see, an indoor space in the center of the city where people working in the city, gather in the center, and they exchange ideas and information. And designers say that it is in these very spaces, in these areas, innovations are born. The second example is the Google headquarters in Mountain View. A very interesting example. We can see here covered spaces, and designers undertook a very interesting approach to the creating the working space. They say forms and types of working of work are changing very fast, and we don't know what they will be in some 20 or 30 years. So building this center for long-term perspective, you have to be aware of how to organize the indoor spaces. It has to be flexible, and it needs to be able to adapt at low cost. So here we see a covered space with a roof that is very innovative. It's like a capsule, and in each cell there are membranes that can open or close independently of other cells, and thus shield from sun, shield certain areas from the sun. We also see how external environment is connected with internal spaces and with open space working environment, which again can adapt to working processes. Here we see main principles of organization of external spaces. The key trend in most projects is not building global infrastructures, but rather bringing nature closer to people, and basically bringing nature back into working environment and living environment. So we believe that Innopolis has a huge resource and potential that needs to be used. Here is another example, Apple headquarters, which is being built right now, also in California, in Cupertino. The example is interesting in the respect that there is this big circle building with a very specific, which Jobs believed will become the best office building in the world. Key principles here are that it has a huge territory, and the buildings will cover 1/4 of the area. That means that free spaces will outdo built areas by 4. There will also be an apricot orchard, which is a hint to the natural environment that used to be there until the building was built. There is also a separation of areas of private and public. When we looked at Google, we saw that all public spaces are allocated both indoors and outdoors, and they're all accessible both for residents and workers, and also for anyone who would be interested to come in and to look at the innovations. In this case, we see a certain delineation of private areas, the so-called patio, and infrastructural facilities that are located along the perimeter which provides a free access, open access.
Apart from that, it's kind of a fast track through examples which we have in the world, because the first three focused mainly on the IT projects, creative environment connected with the high-tech technologies, and we have Masdar City, which aims on developing the energy efficient city with a zero emission city, zero harm to environment. And now we see how this process of organization of the city is coming across some challenges, because they already built a university, and then experience could be probably interesting for in a Polynest example, which we already talked about. It's a Sangdo city in Korea. It's interesting thing that the
planners' approach to the development of the urban environment, not only from the viewpoint of the building infrastructure for the economic zone of the city and the residential areas, the industrial areas, but from the day one, they started developing infrastructure for transport infrastructure and social infrastructure. And now you can say that they don't have full residential capacity, but the city is working, all city processes are going on. For example, the garbage disposal, they have an underground garbage collecting network which collects the garbage from all city and utilizes it and recycles it. And next to Paris, there is a Europa city. It's interesting because the planners from the very beginning were thinking about the residents and about the eventfulness of this area, what can events can be organized there, so they have a clear understanding, clear plan, how this area, how this infrastructure will be used and what people will be doing. So what are the conclusions from this world experience? First of all, that this is a very strong trend to be environment-oriented, nature-oriented. A lot of companies come back to nature. They believe that this is one of the most valuable components, valuable assets of the project, and one of the components which can really attract people and interest them in living in these areas. So this accessibility and openness of spaces of the city, there must be places where people can be 24/7 doing different things. Their families can be there, their friends can be there. So we talked about creation, some kind of the living structure which can be used all the time, and the flexibility and adaptability, because we understand that the world economy is changing, our cities are changing, and you have to think how to organize future and how to build our future with the minimum expenses. The event organization and the organization of the urban space, we have to think about who for we are building the cities and how people will be using this city infrastructure and so-called green mobility. This is something which is very important now. Very briefly, about some words about Innopolis, the principles which can be borrowed from the world experience. It's a flexibility and adaptability of the city space, because city is developing, growing. It's just it's in its very, very initial stage, and you have to think about. We don't have to divide open spaces, closed spaces, private, municipal, public, because as you see in the area where people go to each other, meet and socialize, these are creative places where ideas are being born and innovations are being born. The continuity of the public space, the issues of the transportation, and this is a list of brief recommendations, short recommendations. When we were in Innopolis yesterday, we understood that the involvement of the city dwellers and their opinions, and focusing on residents, on people. We saw it, and we have seen it, and it's very nice that this approach exists, and you have to pay more attention to the centers of the sexual, social activity, and it's very important. And geography, of course, are very important, because in the polis, strategically is in a very advantaged place. There are a lot of different networks, and for example, international airport is in immediate vicinity of this place. There's the high-speed railroad, and as you see, the connection with these infrastructural products are not easy now, and there must be some way how to solve this problem, how to include in a policy into this network, transportation network. And of course, we have to pay more attention to the city, public transportation, to provide mobility for the city. And the last message is we as city planners, urban planners, we can create better conditions to facilitate creativity and creative thinking, but the main generators, main actors of the innovations and life are people and what these people do. Thank you, Timur, a lot. Let me make a little break in our presentations. We have several experts. The question is to Ms. Nigmatulina. You lived in America, worked there, and you know what we're talking about. We're talking about creative urban space. How important is it? Because there are two different approaches. So we build cities, they must something be something surprising. At the same time, there is Silicon Valley, where it was born, there was nothing special, but there was a real innovation boom there. A person was sitting in the garage doing something, nothing special was done for him. But you know what happened in Silicon Valley. So what is important, what can be recommended for the Innopolis? We heard from everybody in the first session, practically when we built create cities, so there is a competition for people. So this is the most important thing, competition for people. If you look at what's going on in IT area in the world with these people, well, I was in a position when I was hiring programmers, IT specialists, and they worked for me. These are people who now are controlling and planning their lives. They say, I want to come to office not at 8 and 9 o'clock. I want to stay at home sometime, work at home. Then maybe at 1 p.m. I'll show up. This flexibility and the IT person programmer, they start managing their life. They have different views at their lives. What's happening with people in 21st century? What is motivation, how we live? These things happen. There is such a writer, Daniel Pin, and he says, what is motivation? What is happiness? Sometime before, it just was survival skills in old times. Then you had to provide some kind of a minimum comfort around you, get some food, go shopping, some very simple fundamental things. And now we have a desire to help somebody, we have a motivation to attach yourself to something great and important. And the third element which we have now, it's getting more and more important, and we have to remember about it when we create these new territories. Silicon Valley went through transitional period in terms of building new comfortable zones, but there was an opportunity to build something new. Opportunity. So we talked about the opportunity in Annapolis to build something new. So there are interesting elements. So that the people who already live there, and Igor and I talked about it, discussed it, 150, 200, 400 people, these people who live there, they can be part of something great. It is something very attractive. These people can manage this city. If we look at some Chinese cities, I think they use not the best examples. Because when we look at China, we're talking about millions. And here we're talking about several thousand people. Later on, you will have 150,000 people. But in the initial stage, we're talking about hundreds. And every person is an individual. And his ideas must be in demand and involve this project. These attractive things which are used, and if you look at the Google Google pictures, you see there colorful bicycles. If you saw this documentary about Google, these colorful bicycles, very important thing. Why bicycles? If you read the book Happiness of Cities, this book was published just 10 years ago. It's written there that the car, it's the place of minimum happiness, because people are isolated from contact with people, because this driving automobile is the less happy moments of your life. But bicycle, you can change the concept of moving, and Google just provided bicycles. So these simple and efficient solutions can be very efficient. What are there other ideas? Attractive things can also be something which connects with the future, because you plan into 20, 30 years perspective, and we have to invent something new. We have to dream not about today, we have to dream about what's going to be 20, 30. We have to dream for our children and grandchildren. It could be a city where you interact with infrastructure, there's interactive everything what we have around us. We have the simple table, simple walls, but in this city there should be something very different. So this fearless mentality, well, yes, maybe you'll be smiling when I'm speaking, but these ideas, if they do cause smile, this idea is worth additional close consideration. Maybe new technologies, and technologies maybe print some interactive screens. So why cannot it be used in the city somehow, in the urban atmosphere? So these ideas are very important. So these new things, these new ideas can give new life to the city. I am a person with a mathematical and financial education, and I believe it's important to look at the economic issues about the sustainability of this city. We heard today this city, the startup, and this is on the stage. It must invent, make up, create new ideas, and all these ideas must work. But we have to understand what is the critical mass for the city when you can move on to different stage, or next stage. And what I'm trying to say is this, the word system is used very often. Everything should be done according to the system. Startup, you don't have to do it in the system. Flexibility, adaptability, how to adjust, it's a unique feature. But where you get this critical mass at, with what number of people, maybe with what money the new concept should appear, how this city should exist when the new stages, new phase comes. That's why economic models will be very important, because the financial aspect in this country, from the budget, we have it now, but we don't have it tomorrow. Political situation must change, can change. And understanding the sustainable economic model is important thing. For me, it was, I was happy that Ross Technology Company is now giving us opportunity to implement some projects. I'm sure it will be very useful for us in developing Innopolis, and in this new phase, Innopolis will be what will be very important for Innopolis. It's active life, some kind of events, some important things happen, events, new people coming, living in the city, see how it develops. So on this stage, this is very important. And my colleague shared the idea with me that there is a program 365 events, and it's important that we have this active life, which is very important. You have given us so many ideas. I liked very much the idea of a city of which you can manage yourself. It's not just a city where you go to get just 5-10 more thousand rubles to work, or because it's in the forest, but you go to the city where you are an important person, in management of which you can participate. Let me continue the idea of using the ideas of the world experience. So Ksenia Makrushina probably can come to us. Ksenia, do you see any trends here?
Good afternoon, colleagues. When I was preparing for this event, I tried to look up what other world experience is available, is out there. What body of knowledge about new cities, new challenges is there? And I was amazed to find out that there is very little information about it. There is very little knowledge, very little research in it. And my very first message to Mr. Ivanov is to use the possibilities to develop the city as the so-called university project, and to help the international community to gather knowledge about the challenges that are related to new cities development, because this is a new, not such a new trend. New cities began to appear a while ago, and there are hundreds of new cities appearing. But we know still very little about the challenges they face. I believe, I'm sure that there is not a single flawless project, and there is not a single successful project. And this makes us think. My second conclusion is, and what has to be kept in mind in Annapolis, maybe this is very trivial, but the conclusion is very deep, actually. New cities are built, it's very difficult to build new cities. There will be lots of challenges, so buckle up and get ready for challenges. Out of all old cities that were started in the early 2000s, half are still dreaming. The second half are only in their first stage. And their completion is being postponed, and many of them will probably be completed by some 2030. So what is preventing this project from success? Of course, there are all subjected to financial crisis, to market trends, which are changing a lot. But I would like to hear from Annapolis, because this is the first large-scale project in Russia, to hear about their plan. How they are going to prepare for future changes, because it is a very long term for dozens or hundreds of years. So what is your resilience plan? What are the key trends here? The first of all, this project has to be not so much a physical project. We are not just building buildings, not just the infrastructures, boxes of buildings. First of all, we're building a communications project. Here I'd like to emphasize, it is not enough to find just unique things. You have to create a systemic, sustainable communicative project, which first of all will focus on the values of the future. I'm really happy to hear that Karima mentioned, at least for the first time, the concept of the future, because we have lots of resources. We're building a new city. This is our only opportunity, possibility to try to feel what urbanism is coming in, what new models of cities, communities we can create, what are the new ways for people to communicate with the city. So all new cities that are being built now, they all look into the future in their own way. So we would like to understand how Annapolis looks into the future, how it is going to address the challenges of the future, and what communicative model it's going to build. The new cities give the possibility to break the stereotypes which the international communities have created about countries in general. This is how important these projects are in terms of communications about the policy around these projects. For example, Masdar, why do people go there? Why future energy specialists go there? Because the city builds the stereotype of UAE as of an energy-based country, which is not really concerned about energy supply at the global level. So Masdar really destroys this negative stereotype. And this is a very good example for Russia. How can we use this city to destroy the negative stereotype of Russia that the world community may have about Russia? Another important trend that has become very clear when we speak about new cities, I call it from smart technologies to smart use of technologies. Again, many new cities come to conclusion that technologies that are used in them get outdated by the time of not even design, by the time the first building gets built. So the whole paradigm of the technologies used have to be changed. Basically, so you have to use technologies very reasonably and in a smart way. So a good lesson here is that new technologies are good, but the comfort of living in new cities is provided not so much by technology, but by basic principles such as environment, residential places, infrastructure, etc. So all these technologies, unique innovations, they work well, but the key lesson here is to create very integrated systems and very flexible systems where you can withdraw something outdated and replace it with something innovative. Not something which is hard to update and renovate. So my message to Innopolis here is use technology smart. Be smart when you invest in new technologies. This is a very contradictory matter. Another important issue is this. We speak a lot, we say this, we keep repeating that Innopolis and other smart cities have to pay off. Again, this is a very risky statement because, yes, we understand that this implies huge investments and states and governments have to get some return on investments, but don't forget, we're building a city here. And first of all, it is a diversity. So a successful city has to be diverse. And it includes different groups of population, different businesses from small markets and Mars to large corporations. So the city has to create conditions where everyone would feel comfortable, small and big, young and old. So all these new cities face this challenge where they rush to get a return investment and they turn into cities for the rich, where the rich invest, but they don't live in those cities. They are not engaged in the development of the cities, in the development of the communities in the cities. Then we have to ask and answer a question, who will do all this? Unfortunately, we have not mentioned this today. They have not mentioned accessibility. Who will this infrastructure will be accessible to? What kind of the so-called clients will have access to it? So this is, even in the word client, raises some concerns. What if the client cannot afford really to live in this city? So we have to basically exclude them from a potential audience. What else I would like? Well, really, you have voiced so many ideas. Hopefully, we will discuss them outside this session as well. So I would like to support everything Timur has said. All these successful cities, well, finally, you can see my presentation here on the screen. So all these new cities cannot but have to use the technologies of sustainable development, of environment, sustainable environment, all these future technologies that are important for international community as well. So in this communications program, these issues have to be mandatory. So this green, this blue infrastructure, eco-mobility, low carbon dioxide sources of energy. So these are the minimum that a city cannot do without. So all these innovative approaches to planning, to design, Timur spoke in a lot of detail about it. I will not repeat him. Here is a very good recipe here that we can see here. To create a great city, you have to set up a great university and wait for some 200 years. So starting a city with a university continues to be a recipe for a successful city. So it is very big asset and advantage that Innopolis has, its university. Thank you very much. To continue this topic, I would like to give the floor to Edouard Moreau, because France has an experience in Technopolis' construction and a famous Technopolis in the Lesser Coast. So what are the trends in the development in European Technopolises?
To put in perspective, Sophia Antipolis in France has been built in the 1970s, so that's 45 years, so compared to 2 years, we can understand how incremental this. You cannot build a city in one day. I just wanted to come back to the previous presentations, because I agree on a lot of the points, and there were some very interesting points made, but I think for the sake of the audience and for the interest of the audience, it would be good to discuss points where perhaps there's disagreement. I think first I was, I don't agree that there's not so many feedbacks or studies about new cities. And new cities have been built for the last 100 years, and there are a lot of experience from Europe after the Second World War, but even recently in the Middle East. Middle East are still building new cities, and there are some experience to be learned. And the second point is, we talked a lot about Masdar, and actually Masdar is very interesting because it's not living to its expectation in reality. And it's, for me, it's an old generation, old model of Technopark, where the emphasis is on the buildings, on so-called smart buildings and very expensive architecture. And in reality, for Innopolis, for innovative cities, what you need is a city first. And you don't necessarily need super smart buildings and super expensive buildings. You need, as it was said before, you need spaces for people simply to meet informally, to drink, to work. Now the city is a workplace. It's not necessarily a fixed workplace with your computer. The city itself is a workplace. So I would say that it's always difficult to build new cities or new environments. I spent myself 5 years of my time building or designing new cities in the Middle East. And I know how incredible it's difficult because you start from a blank page. It has very, very well-known issues of transportation. It's outside the city, so it's car-based. It's very difficult to bring public transport. Can you imagine that Sofia Antipolis, only 45 years after its creation, now they are trying to bring train stations and public transport. And it took 45 years, so let's put that in perspective. I wanted just to add something. It's always good, and I'm always promoting vision of the future. But now clients, my clients, are always asking not only for vision for the future, but a phasing month by month of what needs to be done tomorrow. And I think one of the very important points made by Mr. Ivanov was this chicken and egg situation. How do you bring people in the city? And it's not something that can be done like this. It's an incremental process. The focus needs to be on the people. This was been said before, so that's, I agree on that. So that's it. That's what I'm.
Спасибо большое. Чтобы завершить тему.
Thank you very much. To conclude this topic, we have a number of presentations on Russian experience, but to continue with the world experience, we have a Siemens representative here to continue on the Masdar topic. So just a few words about what are the Masdar status and trends. How is this project progressing? Can you hear me? Masdar is a large-scale project which is developing parallel simultaneously, which was done in cooperation with Siemens. But I would like to separate here Masdar project, Moscow project, and Annapolis projects, because these are slightly different topics. I and many others believe that Annapolis is the project of the Russian Federation, a mega project that will give a certain impetus to economic development in the IT sector. So it will focus on IT technologies, whereas Masdar is really is a high-level environment, first of all, for living of specialists. Of course, it has the university as well that is aimed at development. Moscow is different from Annapolis in the sense that it already has people wanting to go there, so you just need to create environments that specialists will come. Like, for example, is the case with the Silicon Valley. So I actually started with the challenge itself. Now, Annapolis has this task of creating an environment and make sure that it becomes as an economic center of economic development in the IT sector, to become a key player where companies will want to be and where specialists will want to go for high salaries. As I understand, Ross Technologies already have vacancies there and they're all accepting applications.
It's important that the team which are going to collect, will create conditions for the big companies to come, because from the presentations which have been shown, the point of growth is big business, which comes, builds a big headquarters, takes on a lot of new people to work for them. The same story is the Siemens story. There is a city, Erlangen, it was a small village 100 years ago, and Siemens came to this village, opened headquarters, they created university, built a university, and part of the city now is a real R&D center, where they have several departments. It's a big university now, and we're talking about dozens of universities in which technologies are built and which are used by Siemens. And I think this experience can be borrowed and disseminated, can be borrowed by Napolis. It must be point of growth, the point of innovations. Maybe you can invite some events, conferences in Napolis. Well, we already talked that about that some events must be organized in Napolis. It's strange that we are not in Napolis now, such seminar as we have today. Next time, let's do it in Napolis. There are big events in Kazan, the Fair of Innovations of Tatarstan. You have to attract this kind of events. You have to attract investors, venture investors, and conduct startup presentations. But don't limit yourself to IT. Let me say again, there is a big trend that a lot of people move to cities to live. And the big trend is digitalization in our life. We have more and more digital technologies, and the fact is that you are creating IT city, you can also attract industrial technologies. Industrial technologies were based on digital approaches, for example, R&D centers in machine building, tool building. Is Siemens ready to become such resident in Napolis? Will you have a chance to say yes or no? But let me say, mention one mistake of this project. Yes, the approach was correct. Team was correct when it started preparing the concept, in which we as company participated. But you had to create conditions for participation in this project. Did not participate in creating it, the infrastructure of Napolis. And all business or big companies come where business is or where there is a potential. As for potential, yes, that's exactly what I'm talking about. If you show us potential of growth, we definitely will get. I think if the city is 150,000, Siemens will have enough work, yes. We come to go to universities. We work with the leading universities. We started working with the Russian German University Green in Kazan Technological University. We started working there. We're discussing organizing department there. And this is our closest perspective. We are ready to discuss it. Let me get back to the Russian. Let me give floor to Andrei Tiltsov. Andrei, as I told you, was a general planner, or master planner of Skolkovo, which was built with British architect David Adjaye. For Russia, it was a breakthrough project, architectural project. So we talked yesterday about it, why architects and innovators like round houses. When you see innovative center in of Apple or somebody, some other big companies, they're always round. Well, everything has been said before me. One thing what I probably would like to repeat, just to show you a little bit the same things in a different angle based on my own experience. And the experience is,
And it's important that I worked with the London City for the Raymond's brothers, and these old guys, old chaps, told me, Andre, everything is done by people and money. And the difference between London City from Moscow City is when Rahman's brothers started developing this project, the stakes were about 1,700 pounds for square foot. So it's now we have 700 pounds per square meter in London City. To build in London docks, that used to be not in the center of London. London docks, shipyards, were quite far away place, and they promised rates was about 200 pounds per square meter. So it was a two times difference, two times less. They signed all preliminary agreements, memorandums of understanding with the biggest financial companies, institutions. Many of them are based in New York, in Switzerland, which for them to sit in London shipyards, 25 kilometers from the center, it wasn't a problem for them. And they started, they gave start to London City in London shipyards. And people, there was a demand and possibility to satisfy this demand. In London City, they didn't have enough normal offices, good offices, and the prices, the rental prices were very high. And we worked with many technoparks and business parks in the Thames Valley. It's exactly the same story. They built business parks. What is business park? They were just very 2-4 story buildings, very simple, primitive buildings with a minimum rate. The beauty, the beauty of this area was in very comfortable infrastructure with open water spaces. There were swans and ducks around, and the price, these technoparks were built either for small provincial satellite towns around London or for suburban residents. So it was just a matter of price, and the rental rates were two times lower, so companies could choose the rate, transportation, money you have to pay. And so there is a very important factor, what people will go where and what for. People must know that if you move out from center, you either buy or rent, but it must be a specific price, twice cheaper, 1.5 times cheaper. So it must be quite clear picture. As for Skolkovo, let me say again, in Skolkovo we had two different projects, the Moscow School of Management and Skolkovo Innovation Center. Without Moscow School of Management, Skolkova research would never happen, innovation would never happen. International School of Management, actually, it just appeared accidentally, I would have to say. When I speak about the value of people, I probably would like to say some history. We are running out of time. Just can you be just stick to schedule? In this case, that's exactly what we had. It was like it was in Stanford University. They got university in Stanford first. Then there was a difficult financial situation. Then they rented out big pieces of land. Then they built technoparks, which became centers of employment for the Stanford graduates and for the researchers. This is Skolkovo, its example. That is a round hockey puck, as we call it. And this is what Skolkovo again. School of Management. It's very important. It is private project built on private investors' money, which were very happy to build it. The people, this were people who built who their fortunes with billions. These people really wanted to build this school of management. Rubin Vardanyan wrote a program, specific program, and the program for additional education. It was necessary to have the school in Russia. And in 2006, they just started it. It is a public-private partnership. This is Skolko. We go move on. Just two words, how we would. I wouldn't recommend this recipe to any other city. First of all, we understand that Moscow is turning into megapolis, into alpha city, global city, whatever you call it. It is a totally new city development concept. So to copy this experience and build a campus and build several houses or some kind of city blocks as it's in MIT or in Stanford, would you want to do it? The owners or the founders of said that most important that we should be seen from space. It was this approach was like as a cell, as a unit of megapolis. These are the interiors. We wanted to create interiors as the communication space.
I'd like to emphasize there's a very clear difference between public spaces and communication spaces. We architects often make this kind of mistakes. We always design public spaces, not vice versa. So this is the way it looks now. The management school, what it looks like. This is how it started, then was proceeded on to import substitution. Well, really, the project is so interesting. I just fear that these are residential areas, by the way. for conclusion, so we have the two schemes. One is the 2-4 barracks in London shipyards, and the second model of Technopark is... No. Business school is not a Technopark by any means. This is a university which has to appear, first of all, and then in 200 years there will be a city around it. In our case, we're sort of making it happen faster because the city has to appear in the next 10 years. So the science grad feeds on the international management school. What model would you recommend to Innopolis, yours or the London example? For Innopolis, well, I would think the most relevant. First of all, it has to be environmentally friendly model. No transportation. Look at any Swiss or Alpine town, Cervate, I'll say, only electric cars. Zero other kind of transportation, maximum greenery of very diverse plants. There has to be city landscape, but you also have to restore the local nature that used to be there before the construction began. Because, you know, insects are dying out when we build cities. Now, I would like to give the floor to Oleg Shapira, who discusses about public spaces. Because right now we have just an empty field there. So what do you think when we build a new building? Of course, it has to be different, say, from embankments in Moscow. Well, principles have to be different, of course. But I would like to say that development of a city from scratch I think we have completed the first stage, and the next stage is not about city planning. It is more about promoting the natural development of the city. Right now, this is not a city. It is an infrastructure with buildings. It's a place for universities. It's not a university yet. It is a place for residents, but not a residence. So altogether, it is not a city yet. So the key problem here is the contradiction between the natural movement of people, as it was mentioned before, you know, the flow of labor from regions to cities, etc. People are moving in that direction, not really for better conditions, but for having a choice. And we have now to reverse this flow. A person, a qualified person, educated person, someone who got his education in good universities, you know, basically has to... What we are expecting is we're expecting an educated person to say no to the diversity and variety that large cities can offer and prioritize coming to here. So I believe we need some social projects. I believe we already have public spaces there. What we need is to bring people, and they will create these public spaces. I was told that there is already, for example, there is this crosswalk in an empty area. This is similar to what we're trying to do in Tverskaya Street in Moscow. I think what we need is to hear the feedback to real life. This is a real challenge. How do we deal with it? By experimenting. Thank you very much. I'd like to give the floor now to Alexander Loshkin. He has a very good experience with Koltsovo Academic Town. This is Innopolis's of sorts built half a century ago. And he can tell us about life in such places. I will try. Speaking to what Oleg just said, of course it is very important
общественные пространства, но чтобы было еще и общество, которое в этих общественных пространствах, собственно говоря, и развивалось бы, да? Потому что есть очень серьезный вопрос, да? А как будет жить Иннополис на самом деле там через 20, 30, 50 лет, когда иссякнет вот этот вот первоначальный толчок, который сегодня дан? Да?
When this initial impetus be given, will the city continue developing, or will we have to face this, still have to deal with challenges that these monist cities are facing now, which cannot even exist without external, constant external inflow on investment? According to Jane Jacobs, the key function of a city is an extended reproduction of city urban activities. Just a very simple example. We do this with our students in our classes to understand this concept. We assign, for example, you will be a businessman. Come up with a business. What would you need, say, to set up a florist studio? You will need somebody to manufacture the studio itself. You need supplies of flowers, you need logistics expert, a transportation company, etc., etc. And the transportation company needs suppliers of fuel, supply manufacturers of cars, various facilities. And there is this kind of a chain, this mechanism of expanded reproduction of urban activities. When any activity in a city entails a number of other types of activities, and the parks, technoparks, science parks, or science towns, or Innopolises of different scales, these are the methods, the ways to apply this mechanism of the so-called city reactor, city engine. And a means to increase activities. So we're speaking not about just people who accidentally meet in the city and then they come up with different activities. Basically, you bring people here with different educational backgrounds and competences, assuming that, say, a biophysicist meets an IT expert, and together they will make a breakthrough in breakthrough. And that will create more activity in the city. It will generate new things and new ideas. And that will help the city grow and develop. So we'll basically start this city reactor. Speaking of international experience, some 60 or 70 years ago, Russian experience, the academic town started some 70 or 60 years ago. It was started as, I'm not even sure if the authors were aware of that, it was started as the so-called city reactor, urban reactor. It was created as an interdisciplinary center which had physicists, poets. Initially, there were up to 13 universities of different profiles, of different competences. There was a university educational institution as well. Importantly, why it wasn't set up in Moscow and Leningrad? To make sure that it was independent of existing educational institutions and schools. So this was called sort of a lift, a social lift. There was also a huge industrial center where all these new developments could be implemented immediately. And indeed, this mechanism did work, because in some 10 years,
the number of institutions and universities grew to 40 from 13. And of course, there were all sorts of activities, social activities, disputes, the first technology transfer companies, innovative companies, a major symphonic orchestra, etc. And what happened next is some sort of a fading out of this kind of these activities, because everything was focused on science. But scientists sometimes get children who do not necessarily become scientists. So where can they then apply their talents? In Novosibirsk again, in the same place. And incrementally, the academic town was turning into the so-called sleeping quarters. The traffic, the movement, the communications between academic city and Novosibirsk grew. And by the 70s, they had this new challenge. Now there are certain attempts being done to restart the city engine, city reactor. Of course, the potential is still there because the level of science competences is still high. Private business, for example, is using it a lot. For example, in the IT sector, that is developing very fast there. The state is also trying to use it. In part through the Technopark project. I cannot say that this place is just as effective as it was in the 60s, though. Another example is a reverse, a different example, the Koltsovo Science City example. It is the fourth academic town in Novosibirsk. Altogether, there are four of them. So this is the last one built in the Soviet times. It was built at the Microbiology Institute. Now it is a vector R&D institution. And it didn't have this interdisciplinarity. It was a very typical monosettlement, monotown, where everything was connected on this city, on the key enterprise. And in the 90s, they had major problems because when the state funding stopped, discontinued, and there wasn't enough funding even for maintaining the city infrastructure. So the problem that they had, this problem basically became an impetus for the city reactor. What happened? Vector, that used to be an R&D institution, it set up several technology transfer innovative centers and started creating its own developments, technologies. For example, Bifido Kefir, a dairy product. That is something that was started exactly in the 90s. So all these dairy products with Bifido bacteria were actually launched in the 90s. Or antiviral drugs. And etc., etc. And these companies required a new infrastructure, and they started creating new businesses around them. It was supported by the top management of the R&D institution, and this mechanism was started. Presently, the Vector settlement or town has an innovative center, has a business incubator, a biotechnological park.
There are a lot of different manufacturing facilities. Most of them were microbiology industry oriented, but new ones started to come up, and a lot of people were surprised when, for example, they started the alcohol manufacturing, producing alcohol. In Technopark, they have a grain processing facility, And this grain processing facility just connected with the bacteria production. They produce yeast, bran from grain, and one of the byproducts is alcohol. And the liquor company was included into this production chain, and now this town has 14,000 people, and they have 670 million rubles in its budget, and it generates 8 billion rubles to different budgets, taxes, and they get this about only 7 million triple rubles for their citizen. It is very, very small, and from federal budget. And they built about 2 square meters of residential area per capita. So they did manage to start these mechanisms which exist independently and which provide sustainability for this for the people. It's a very comfortable place to live in. And now how can we limit the number of people who want to live and work there? It says next question. Probably we will not dwell on it. Yuri, thank you very much. Hasan Yuri, we have one more expert, Mikhail Alexeyevsky. I would like to ask him and very briefly let him answer. We've been talking a lot about that there are a lot of places, facilities in the city, but there is no city. So how can you weave this fabric of urban space? What is first, the chicken or a chicken or an egg? Let me begin with a metaphor which I believe describes very vividly what the city planners doing. It's a metaphor of biological experiment when you have an empty valve, a very vessel, and you have to create some kind of a nutrition substance there and attract some kind of organisms which can thrive in this biological matter, biological mixture. And I think that there is some kind of a disbalance. And there are some nuances which are very important for this growth of living matter in this laboratory vessel. We are all competing for the human capital. We have to attract best brains. But you have to understand that IT people, these are very special breed of clever and talented people which are extremely mobile. That is why they move so rapidly everywhere. And theoretically, you can live on the city in the ocean coast and with a notebook and work from there. And to lure these quite choosy and free people to this new city, I see two main things which can attract them. First is to ability to work with the same people as you are, with which you can discuss things and develop breakthrough projects. And second is the comfort of the city area. Let's be very honest. In Russia, there are not many cities with a comfortable city urban environment. And here you can create it from scratch. And that is why let's not talk only about medicine, build hospitals, school, kindergarten, but also about those nuances which are very important, so that these different forms of life, let me put it this way, work and live together. And here I see, from the viewpoint of practical recommendations, when we talk about what Alexei talked about, populating this new city. A city needs places for communication. And the communication space, not just park where a lot of people walk and but some places where these talented people can get together, discuss something, and generate some ideas. When we were yesterday, we asked how people have rest there. People say that conditions are quite good, so you can go have a barbecue party on the bank of River Volga. You have to think more about things. Well, I'm not sure that there is a very good and comfortable place for the barbecue place, although it's very, very cheap to do it. But let's call it the barbecue parties, barbecue meetings. During this kind of informal events, the best startups are born in this informal socialization. And the last thing what I want to say, it's just some food for thought for future. We talked about the underground crossings, which look like futuristic. You want to just it's show the how it will look in future. I think that as for the social development, social cultural development, and environment, if you really want these people to live and feel themselves comfortable, you have to think about it too. For example, I was very much surprised that there is no such thing as a city center, as a downtown. We all remember about the historical importance of the city hall center, market center. When I said, where is the city center? It was university. I think it's wrong. University cannot be a city center. There must be a place where all city dwellers get together to celebrate New Year party. Again, it's very simple to do it, but I didn't see it. It's very easy to forget about it. And you have to think about it now, because later on will be difficult to do. Thank you very much. To round up this coffee, this round table, let me say a couple of things. Our round table is over, but I think it's obvious that that it is... This is very important that we can collect people from all over the place, and this is the only way you can create this area. And the second is, let me say specifically to the mayor, I participated in one project with very famous people, and he said that there isn't not money, a lot of money in this project, but the chance to participate in the reformation of big country. It's a unique chance and for a chosen few. It was a kind of a joke, of course, but I really, really envy you that you are building new city from scratch, and I wish you good luck. Thank you.